Hello students, today we are going to learn about agriculture, that is chapter 4 of geography class 10. So agriculture, as you know, is one of the economic activity in India. It is one of the age old activities of India. Since time immemorial we have been practicing agriculture. A settled way of life started from agriculture. So agriculture is the primary occupation of more than half of the population of Indians. We are very dependent, India is very dependent on its agriculture income, because a large segment of the population are dependent on agriculture. Basically there are different type of agriculture we will speak out, and first set of form of agriculture is the primitive subsistence farming, also known as a slash and burn agriculture or the shifting agriculture or cultivation. So it is generally practiced in tribal pockets or tribal hamlets, where mostly tribal people live in forested regions. They cut a piece of forest, they clear the land and fell down the trees, burn the trees, and with the ashes seeds are sown, mostly hardy crops, and from there they generate their harvest for a couple of years. As the soil fertility declines, they move to a fresh patch of land, and after cultivating for a couple of land, the land becomes uneconomical, it produces less, and they leave the soil to replenish its fertility for 12 to 18 years. So in different parts of India it is practiced, and it is only for the self or family consumption, and it is known by different names. For example, it is jhum in northeastern states like Assam, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Nagaland, Pamalu in Manipur, Dipa in Bastar district of Chhattisgarh, and in Andaman and Nicobar Island. Also in different parts of the world it is also known by different names: Milpa in Mexico, Central America, Conoco in Venezuela, Roca in Brazil, Masole in Central Africa, Ladang in Indonesia, Re in Vietnam. Next we'll come to the intensive subsistence farming. As you know, the farm holding size has become uneconomical due to increase in population. Today the land man ratio has become more, the demand for food production has grown up, and that's why there is a tremendous pressure on land to generate more food. So that's why we are using HYV seed, chemical fertilizer, machine tools, pesticides and irrigation techniques in order to generate more harvest. And this is known as intensive subsistence farming. Here also it is generated for the self-consumption or family consumption. As the land holding size is uneconomical or small, it is fragmented. So that's why it doesn't produce much for the market. Next we'll come to the commercial farming. So commercial farming also uses scientific method of farming. Here the land holding size is more. It is a bigger patch of land, it is a big portion or size or chunk of land which is cultivated. It generates more, and generally it is meant for the market. It is meant for the market. Here there is higher productivity. Farmer can sell the surplus amount in the market. Plantation is also a type of commercial farming. In the plantation agriculture, what happens? A big patch of area is taken, and it is cultivated with a specific breed or variety of crop, and it generates harvest for 2 to 3 years once the plantation is done. And mostly plantations are labor intensive things, and they require huge amount of labor. So for example, the different type of plantation crops in India: tea, coffee, rubber, sugarcane, bananas, etc. are different type of plantation crop. And as you know, Indian tea is very famous. It is one of the very best known plantation crop in India, in Assam, hills of Darjeeling, and in different parts of South India. It is very intensively cultivated. Also Karnataka is very famous for its coffee plantations. Next we'll move to the different cropping season in India. Basically there are three cropping season in India: Rabi, Kharif and Zaid. Rabi season, this is the winter season crop, and generally it is from October to December when it is the seeds are sown, and it is harvested in the summer months from April to June. And the most important Rabi crop is wheat. And northern plains or the Gangetic plains are very known for the well drained soil and for the fertility of the soil, because here it is the entire patch is alluvial soil, very fertile soil, and it is the best known soil. And areas such as Punjab, Haryana, Himachal, Jammu and Kashmir, Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh are very important for the production of wheat and other major Rabi crops. And another one, the suitable factor is the western temperate cyclonic disturbances occur in these areas during the winter season, which is very helpful for the growth of the rabi crops because it gives rainfall during the time of the sowing. Next, moving to the kharif season. Kharif season is the monsoon season. Crop is also known as the kharif season, and the most important crop here is rice. Rice is a semi-aquatic crop and it requires ample amount of rain. And kharif season is best suited for rice cultivation. So basic or the main areas for rice cultivation are the eastern parts and southern parts of India are dedicated to rice cultivation. Assam, West Bengal, coastal regions of Odisha, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Maharashtra are very important areas for rice consumption. Recently, paddy has also become somewhat important in these areas. So in Assam, there are three rice growing season, that is Aus, Aman and Boro. Remember, in Assam, there are three rice growing season, that is Aus, Aman and Boro. In a year, thrice the rice cultivation is done in these places. In between Rabi and Kharif season, there is a short summer season crop that is known as a Zaid. In this season, watermelon, muskmelon, cucumber and different type of fruits are generated by the farmers for a good harvest, and this short summer season crop is known as Zaid. Next, we will move to the major crop varieties which are available in India. So there are variety of crops which are done in India. The major crops grown in India are rice, wheat, millet, pulses, tea, coffee, sugarcane, oilseeds, cotton and jute, etc. First major crop which majority of Indians consume is the rice. It is a staple diet of Indians, and India ranks second after China in the terms of rice production. So it is a kharif crop which requires high amount of temperature and high rainfall also. It requires more than 25 degree of temperature, whereas its rainfall requirement is more than 100 cm. And in the areas of less rainfall, it grows with the help of irrigation techniques. So major areas of rice which are grown in India are the eastern areas and the deltas or the coastal plains of Odisha. Next, we'll go to the wheat. Wheat, as you know, it is a major rabi crop in the country. This is the second most important cereal crop, the main food crop in north and northwestern part of the country. So this rabi crop requires a cool growing season and a bright sunshine at the time of ripening. It requires about 50 to 75 cm of annual rainfall, and there are mostly two wheat growing zones in the country, that is the Ganga Satluj plains and the Deccan Trap area. Next, coming to the millets. Millets are a group or a bunch of inferior crops that are called as a millets. Jowar, Bajra, Ragi are important millet crop grown in India. Jowar, Bajra and Ragi, remember, that is the important millets which are grown in India. They may have a very coarse taste, but they are higher in nutritional value. So, for example, Ragi is very rich in iron, calcium and other micronutrients and roughage. So, Jowar is also the third important major food crop in India in respect to the area grown. And major Jowar producing states are Maharashtra, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh. Bajra, as you know, grows in the sandy soils and shallow black soil. So, the major states where Bajra grown is Rajasthan, UP, Maharashtra, Gujarat and Haryana. Ragi is a crop of dry regions and grows well on red, black, sandy and shallow black soils. The major areas where ragi is produced is Tamil Nadu, Himachal, Uttarakhand, Sikkim, Jharkhand and Arunachal Pradesh. Maize. This is one of the important crop which is both used as food and as well as fodder. It requires 21 to 27 degree Celsius temperature, grows well in the old alluvial soil. It is the only crop which requires old alluvial soil or the bangar, and we are now using modern inputs such as HYV seed, fertilizer, irrigation. This has contributed to the increase in the production of maize crop. Major states which produces maize are Madhya Pradesh, UP, Bihar, Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. Next, we'll come to the pulses. India is the largest producer as well as consumer of pulses, and it is one of the major source of protein for a vegetarian diet. And this crop is grown in rotation with the rice crop because pulses make nitrogen fixation in the soil, which enriches the soil with nitrogen and which is helpful for the growth of rice crop. And all the pulses do nitrogen fixation except one, that is arhar. And these are leguminous crop. Major pulses producing states in India are Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Maharashtra, UP and Karnataka. Next we will come to the food crops other than greens that are sugarcane. Sugarcane, it is a tropical, it is a plantation crop, and it once it is grown, it can, we can harvest sugarcane for 2 to 3 years. So it requires a cool climate, humid climate with temperature of 21 degree to 27 degree and a rainfall between 75 and 100 cm. Irrigation is required in the areas of low rainfall. It can be grown on a variety of soils and needs manual labor from sowing to harvesting. It is the India is the second largest producer of sugarcane next to Brazil, and it is the main source of different type of products from sugarcane, that is gur, khandesari, sugar and molasses. So the major sugarcane producing states are UP, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Telangana, Bihar, Punjab and Haryana. Oil seeds. In 2015, India was the second largest producer of groundnut in the world, next to China. In rapeseed production also, India was the third largest producer in the world after Canada and China in 2015. 12% of the total cropped area is devoted to the oilseed cultivation in India. So major oilseed cultivated in India are soybean, sesamum, coconut, mustard, cottonseed, linseed and sunflower. Some of these are edible and most of them are used as cosmetic products. And some of them, majority of them are used as cooking medium. Groundnut is a kharif crop and it accounts for the half of the major oilseed produced in the country. Gujarat was the largest producer of groundnut, followed by Rajasthan, Tamil Nadu, and in linseed and mustard and rabi crops. Sesamum is a kharif crop. It is grown in north and rabi crop in the South India. Castor seed is grown both as a rabi and kharif crop. Next plantation crop is tea. Tea cultivation is an example of plantation agriculture. The British introduced tea crop in India. It was extensively cultivated in Assam, hills of Darjeeling, in Jalpaiguri district of West Bengal. The tea plant grows well in tropical and subtropical climate. It requires deep, well-drained and fertile soil and rain, frequent rain showers throughout the year for the tender growth of the leaves. And one thing is important, that in the tea garden itself, there are tea processing units to process the raw tea for regaining its freshness, or the aroma is intact so that it doesn't diffuse in the climate. So that's why it, within the tea garden itself, the tea is processed. It requires cheap and well-trained labor, and it is an industry which grows on goes on throughout the year. Next important crop is coffee. Coffee was initially introduced by the British in India. It was in the Nilgiris area, and now also it is restricted to Nilgiris. So the Arabica varieties of coffee was grown in India. It is best known for its quality. It was initially brought from Yemen, and it is restricted to the Baba Budan hills of Nilgiris, and that is in Karnataka, Kerala and Tamil Nadu. Horticulture. Next, coming to horticulture, the growth or the process of cultivation of fruits and vegetables is known as horticulture. In 2015, India was the second largest producer of vegetables in the world after China. It is a producer of tropical as well as temperate fruits. So different parts of India are very famous for different type of crops which are grown. Mangoes of Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, UP and West Bengal, oranges of Nagpur and Cherrapunji, bananas of Kerala, Mizoram, Maharashtra, lychee and guava of UP and Bihar, pineapples of Meghalaya, grapes of Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Maharashtra, apple, pears and apricot, walnuts of Jammu and Kashmir and Himachal Pradesh are in great demand throughout the world. These are the horticulture crops which are produced in India. Next, coming to the non-food crop, that first one is rubber. Rubber is an equatorial crop. So under special condition, it grows in tropical as well as subtropical areas. It requires a rainfall, more than 200 cm of rainfall. That means in the areas of evergreen forest, we can cultivate rubber. So rubber is important industrial raw material, and it is abundantly grown in Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Andaman and Nicobar, and Garo Hills of Meghalaya. Fiber crop, cotton, jute, hemp and natural silk are the four major fiber crops which are grown in India. Cotton, jute, hemp and natural silk are the important fiber crop which is grown in India. So apart from silk is produced from the cocoon of the silkworm, which is grown in the mulberry trees, and the rest three, that is cotton, jute and hemp, are natural products which are obtained from plants. So cotton, India is believed to be the home of natural cotton plant, and cotton is one of the major raw materials of Indian textile industry. In 2015, India was the second largest producer of cotton after China. Cotton grows well in the drier part of the black cotton soil or the regur soil. It requires high temperature, light rainfall and 210 frost free days and bright sunshine for its growth. It is a kharif crop and requires 6 to 8 months to mature. And major cotton producing areas are Maharashtra, Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Tamil Nadu. Jute, also known as a golden fiber, it grows in the well-drained, fertile alluvial soil and mostly in high temperature areas of West Bengal, Bihar, Assam, Odisha and Meghalaya. So major jute producing states, it is included in making of the gunny bags, mats, ropes, yarn and different artifacts. But today jute is losing its market to synthetic fibers because it is less costly. So India is one of the agriculturally dominant country, but it is lagging behind than advanced country in terms of agriculture because of its primitive method of farming. So agriculture as an requires a lot of technical development and institutional development. So since independence, there are many things which are taken into consideration to improve the lot of Indian agriculture. So what are the techno-institutional reforms which have been carried out after independence? We will find out here. So agriculture, which provides livelihood for more than 60% of the Indians, requires some serious technical and institutional reforms. So some of the method to improve the lot of Indian agriculture was collectivization. Collectivization, consolidation of land holdings, cooperation and abolition of jamindari were some of the important steps which were taken into consideration after independence. Collectivization. The term collectivization means that literally all the village available in the land are pulled together and they are cultivated together by all the shareholders of the village, means all the farmer of the village, and the harvest is equally shared between the members. That is called as a collectivization. Consolidation of the land holding means fragmented piece of lands are joined together. Okay, there were fragments pieces of land once scattered over different areas, so mutually exchange was done and it was put together into a compact block so that there would be more convenience in farming. So this is called as a consolidation of land holding, cooperation and abolition of jamindari. Abolition of jamindari means after there were jamindars in various parts of India, in various villages, in various localities, jamindars were there who had lot of lands. This land was taken back, the powers of the jamindar was taken back, and the land was redistributed among the different farmers who were marginal or had no land. This was abolition of jamindari, which gained importance after India's independence. So from the first 5-year plan itself, the impetus was given to development of agriculture since 1951, and we have been giving priority to Indian agriculture. So mid-1950s and 60s, there was a growth of another one scientific program that was known as the Green Revolution. Green Revolution was a pilot project in order to make India self-sufficient in terms of food grains. The availability of food grains, and we no longer were dependent upon the other countries for the survival, so that we would not be asking for other countries to send us food grain. That was under the leadership of our former Prime Minister Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. The impetus to Green Revolution took place. Here two important scientists, Indian scientists were there, Dr. Norman Borlaug and Dr. M.S. Swaminathan, were the pioneers of the Indian Green Revolution. So here HYVC, chemical fertilizer, pesticide, irrigation and machine tools were to be taken and grouped and punched into the land so that there would be greater yield. After Green Revolution, there followed White Revolution. White Revolution, also known as Operation Flood. Here, the main component was milk production. India is having number one in cattle population, but in milk production, we are lacking behind. So, this was Dr. Varghese Kuren, who was responsible for India's White Revolution. And similarly, other kind of revolution took place in order to improve the lot of Indian agriculture. Next, by 1980s and 90s, there was comprehensive land development programs, and it included both technical and institutional reforms. For example, provision for crop insurance against flood, drought, cyclone, fire and disease. There were establishment of Grameen banks or rural banks, which are now present in all areas of the country. Cooperative societies were established, and there were societies for providing loans to the farmers at low rate of interest. Again, there were Kisan credit card, personal accident insurance schemes, or some other of the schemes which were given benefit to the farmers. Apart from this, there were other innovative programs which were launched in the radio and television in order to help farmers. There are dedicated call center facilities also for farmers, where they can ask different questions regarding their crop or issues regarding to their crop and how to attain sustainability. So now every year MSP are declared before every cropping season. Minimum support price is declared so that the farmers are not exploited in the hands of middlemen. And next, in the last thing, is the Bhudan movement. Bhudan movement was initiated by an Acharya Narahari Vinoba Bhave. It is also known as a bloodless revolution, where there was this Vinoba Bhave moved from place to place, and he asked for the Jamindars to give away their surplus land so that it would be redistributed among the farmers or those who were in need. And he collected a lot of land and gave away to the people who were in need or who were in distress. And this revolution is known as a Bhudan movement or the bloodless revolution. This is your complete chapter on agriculture. That is chapter 4 of your geography class 10. Thank you.